good?
To drink when I talk.
Okay. Excellent.
As long as I've had my morning shot of caffeine.
That's the only necessity. Otherwise, things don't go well.
Bonjour à tous. Good morning, everyone. Please stand for our national anthem. Thank you. Please be seated. Welcome to Friday at FMF. I am Dr. Francine Lemire, Executive Director and CEO at the College of Family Physicians of Canada, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to this morning's exciting FMF keynote session. We would like to acknowledge the Mississaugas of the New Credit, on whose territory we are guests. We express our gratitude to them, as well as the Wendat, the Anishinaabe, Oden Hoshone, Inuit and Métis people for their stewardship of the land. We would like to recognize that the relationship our ancestors and Indigenous peoples had with each other and with the land are described in the Treaty of Niagara of 1764 and remain important to Canada today. The CFPC acknowledges our treaty obligations and the many historic injustices experienced by Canada's Indigenous peoples. We commit ourselves to forging a new relationship and to seeking reconciliation. I will begin with some introductions of today's platform party. I ask those three people to stand, and then perhaps you can acknowledge them at the same time. Dr. Paul Sawchuk, CFPC President-elect. Dr. Guillaume Charbonneau, CFPC President, for another hour or so. And Dr. Cindy Blackstock, today's keynote speaker. Nous sommes ravis d'avoir avec nous aujourd'hui plusieurs anciens présidents nationaux du Collège. Je les présenterai un peu plus tard au cours de la matinée. I would like to welcome other members of the CFPC Board of Directors and elected leaders of our provincial chapters who are seated in the audience. I will ask them to stand and be recognized, and I would ask you to hold your applause until they've all been introduced. From BC, Dr. Jeanette Boyd, President of the British Columbia College of Family Physicians. Dr. Ainsley Mikulchuk, President of the Manitoba College of Family Physicians. Dr. Frédéric Turgeon, President du Collège québécois des médecins de famille. Dr. Darren Martin, President of the New Brunswick College of Family Physicians. Dr. Natasha Deschwal, President of the Nova Scotia College of Family Physicians. Dr. Nicole Stockley, President of the Newfoundland and Labrador College of Family Physicians. Dr. Nadine Arsenault-Sanson, President of the Prince Edward Island College of Family Physicians. From our CFPC Board of Directors, Dr. Jean-Pierre Arsenault, Dr. Carrie Bernard, Dr. Brady Bouchard, Dr. Kathy Chervin, Dr. Marie Giroux, Dr. Alan Katz, Dr. John Maxted, Dr. Christy Newton, and Dr. Shirley Shepherd. Thank you. We will now begin today's program with an introduction of Dr. Cindy Blackstock as the 2018 recipient of the Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine, TD Insurance, Spotlight on Achievement Award. First, a couple of words about the award. This award is bestowed on an outstanding national or international figure who has contributed significantly to medicine, family medicine, and/or the health and well-being of the population in Canada and/or around the world. Recipients have articulated the unique sphere of influence of family physicians as agents of change in communities and the importance of healthcare policies in supporting this role. With this award, we are very pleased to recognize Dr. Blackstock's outstanding work as a social worker and her dedication to child protection and Indigenous children's rights. She is the Executive Director of the First Nations Child and Family Caring Society of Canada and a professor with the School of Social Work at McGill University. Dr. Blackstock is a member of a Jikstan First Nation, a notable author and a public speaker. Son travail visant à promouvoir les solutions adaptées culturellement et qui repose sur des données probantes a été reconnu, entre autres, par l'Initiative des femmes Nobel, par la Fondation nationale des réalisations autochtones et par Frontline Defenders. Dr. Blackstock collabore avec d'autres leaders autochtones pour aider le Comité des Nations Unies sur les droits de l'enfant à élaborer et à adopter une déclaration générale sur les droits des enfants indigènes. Dr. Blackstock, welcome. We look forward to your presentation.
What a great honor to be here today and at a time in our country when we all hold within our power to raise a generation of First Nations, Métis, and Inuit children who never have to recover from their childhoods, and a generation of non-Indigenous children who never have to say their story. And there is one underlying issue that we have to get at, and that is the unequal treatment of First Nations children in the provision of public services. Since Confederation, First Nations children have received less for water, less for basics like sanitation, less for child and family services, less for health care than all other children in Canada. And the reason for that is that the federal government funds these services on reserve, whereas the provinces and territories fund them for all others. And the Canadian public has been woven a narrative by the Canadian government and the provincial and territorial governments as if First Nations kids get more. So what we have are children who are getting less across every life experience, but are often judged by a society that thinks they're getting more. And what do children do? They internalize that. These kids in these First Nations communities don't know they're getting less. All they know is life is much more difficult for them than it is for their non-Indigenous peers, and so they start to believe that they're the problem. And that is the toxicity of inequality. Now, some people say, there's a couple of reasons that this has persisted for 152 years. Number one, we didn't know about it. And that, I'm going to show you, is false. We have always known about it. Number two, there were not solutions for it. And that too is false. There always were solutions to it. And number three, we are so broke as a nation that First Nations children need to wait in the wings until we get our economic house in order, until we can treat them equally. And that, I say, is immoral and illegal. And we need to kind of stop the normalization of this inequality for children and the families that they love and care for them. Now, here's the perfunctory slide. You've seen it before. And just to say that I don't have any financial relationships, and thank heaven no one lets me near the medicine because I don't have the skill set you do. There was a man who was a great hero in Canada, and his name is Peter Henderson Bryce. He was actually born in Mount Pleasant, Ontario, not far from here, near the Six Nations community. He wrote Canada's first public health code, and he's widely credited for saving the lives of at least 15,000 people because there was an infectious disease outbreak in Montreal, and he stopped the trains from going westward. He was president of the American Public Health Association. He was also the founder of the Canadian Public Health Association. And for that alone, he should be writ large in the medical texts of this country. And in fact, in the moral consciousness of this country, and one of the people that we celebrate most lively. But he was erased from Canadian history for what he did at the age of 51. He is recruited by the Department of Indian Affairs to go out and survey the health of children in residential schools. And what does he find? Well, he finds that the death rate is about 25% per annum. And if you track the children over 3 years, nearly half would be dead. In one school for which there were complete death records, for every 3 children that walked in alive, only 1 would walk out. Now, Dr. Bryce was a scientist, and he also was a doctor. And he said medical science knows just what to do. So as horrible as the situation was, he was confident that when he came back to the Canadian government and presented his solution, that the Canadian government would take it up with great vigor. Here's the problem, he said. We are giving 3 times the amount of health care funding to the citizens of Ottawa than we are to all First Nations across Canada. If we even that out, we would be able to save some of these children's lives. Especially if we implemented some practical reforms, like not putting sick children in with healthy children, improving ventilation, reducing their exhaustion from servitude, and giving them a decent diet. Now, the Canadian government said no, it would cost too much. The cost of Bryce's reforms back then was about $10,000 to $15,000. For $10,000 to $15,000, we could have gone a long way to saving the over 6,000 children that the Truth and Reconciliation Commission said died in residential schools. But the price was too high for Canada. And so what did Dr. Bryce do? Well, he stood by his Hippocratic Oath. He made sure the Canadian public knew about this because he was confident that the Canadian public, the people of that period, would stand up and rise up against this inequality. So his report appears on the front page of the Evening Citizen, which is now the Ottawa Citizen, also carried by the Globe and as far west as the Victoria Columnist. Editors of that period thought this was so egregious, they often put it on the front page. And one of the leading lawyers of that time said that, his name is Samuel Hume Blake, said that in that Canada fails to obviate the preventable causes of death, it brings itself into unpleasant nearness with manslaughter. So people of that period thought this inequality in the provision of public services and the related harms and deaths of children was not only immoral, it quite possibly was criminal. And yet, there was not a sufficient voice that rose up in order to make sure Canada did the right thing. Years later, after report after report mounts about these inequalities, we get to Sheila Fraser, who did 18 reports on the situation of First Nations people in this country. Everything from the provision of water, and as some of you know, only 1 in 6 First Nations still don't have clean water to drink. Can you imagine, right? And we've allowed this to continue. The government says it's complicated to get clean water to First Nations. And some people think, well, that's because they live in these far-flung places, but there is a water advisory 1.5 hours outside of Toronto. And if we can get clean drinking water pumping in third world nations where we send foreign aid, can't we do it in Northern Ontario? Can't we do it in Southern Ontario? We've allowed ourselves to digest this diet of normalizing the discrimination and allowing our elected leaders to get off with it. And it doesn't matter how credible the voice is. Sheila Fraser, of course, is one of the most credible auditor generals we had. And she, and upon her her moving on, said this was one of the areas of the most profound disappointment. She found the government accepting the findings of her reports, but then not doing anything, or only doing a little bit. What is the consequence of this today? A lot of people look at residential schools and say, well, thank heaven the last one closed in 1996. But did the effects close in 1996? We have 12 times as many First Nations children in child welfare care today than non-Indigenous children. The key factors are inadequate housing, poverty, aided by things like a lack of sanitation and water, and also multi-generational trauma that manifests itself in substance misuse. All things we could do something about. But all of that is overladen by another level of inequality. Those inequalities that Bryce talked about continue to persist. So in 2000, when we did a study, we found that Canada was shorting First Nations kids in child welfare by 30 cents on the dollar. And that shortage was particularly in services to keep kids at their homes. So when you don't have any money to keep kids in their homes, when you're dealing with families with these profound traumas in residential school and inequality across every service, what happens? We get overrepresentation. But I don't like that word because it's too easy to say. I like to think of it the way kids think of it, which is how many sleeps till I see my mom or my dad or my brother or sister or my dog or my cat? If we only look at the data for on-reserve children, this is on-reserve children only, and we look at it from that snapshot of between 1989 and 2017, First Nations kids have spent 78 million nights of childhood in foster care. Now that is an astounding figure. When we compare it against the historical records, there are three times as many First Nations children in child welfare care than there was at the height of residential schools. So the opportunity to do something about the tragedy unfolding in front of us is not behind us, it's with us right now. Now Canada, as I said, had numerous reports documenting the inequality. More importantly, they had economically costed solutions to deal with it. They did exactly what they did in Bryce's time and what they did with Sheila Fraser. Yes, we agree with the report. We even have letters from the minister saying how credible the reports are. And then they go on to say they're going to review the report, which too often means doing nothing or doing very little. So in 2007, the organization I work for, the nonprofit, the First Nations Child and Family Caring Society, partnered with the Assembly of First Nations, and we took Canada to the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal. We alleged their unequal provision of child and family services and their failure to implement Jordan's principles so First Nations children could access other public services when they need them amounted to racial discrimination against 165,000 children. It is the only time in the Western world we know of where a government has been taken to court for its current treatment of this generation. We didn't want to see Canada do another apology, because when they apologize, that child's childhood has already been ruined. We wanted to stop the policy from going forward. Canada did not appreciate it. They did pretty much what they did with Bryce. They retaliated and then buried it. They brought 8 motions to try and dismiss the case, but they were unsuccessful, and finally, in 2016, the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal issued a landmark ruling. They found that Canada is, in fact, racially discriminating against these children and ordered the federal government to stop. It was a euphoric day for many of us, but we also knew that the power of that decision is only when children's lives change. We saw 2 ministers from the government get up and welcome the decision, and then they did nothing. They did nothing for several months. And one of the key pieces of this decision is Jordan's principle. We've now had 5 non-compliance orders since that decision has been issued, and we're starting to see some compliance from the federal government. And one of the key areas for you and your practice is Jordan's Principle. Jordan's Principle is named in memory of Jordan River Anderson, a little guy from Norway House Cree Nation, who was born in 1999. He had a medical condition that was quite rare, and that required him to be hospitalized for 2 years. His doctors, some of you may know Dr. Brian Postol from the University of Manitoba, the Dean of Medicine there was his physician. They provided excellent care, and they were able to get to a point where Jordan could be discharged to a medically trained foster home near the hospital, so if anything went wrong, he would have access to the hospital, and then stabilize there and then go home to Norway House, where his family was from. If he was not a First Nations child, he would have gone home at the age of 2, there's no question. Everything was there. Manitoba would have picked up the payment. But because he was First Nations, Manitoba said he's a federal responsibility. And the federal government looked amongst its numerous departments and argued over who should pick up the tab. The bureaucrats decided that instead of setting a precedent where one government picks up the tab for a child, that's something we don't want to do, they felt, they're going to leave Jordan in hospital while they argued over each service. Jordan stayed there for 2.5 years before, as his sister said, he dies of a broken heart. At the age of 5, he goes into a coma and passes away, never having spent a day in a family home because he was a First Nations child. The family asked that we do something with his memory, and that is to make sure it never happened to other kids, and we knew it was. At the time, we did a research project with the Government of Canada in only a sample of 12 of the 105 First Nations agencies that existed then, and we found just about 400 children who are being denied services because they're First Nations. But the tribunal has now said Jordan's Principle is a legal requirement on the government. It applies to all First Nations children. It applies to all First Nations children on and off reserve. It applies to all public services. So if you come across a child in your practice who needs a learning assessment, for example, that can be covered by Jordan's Principle. Or if you have a child that needs medical equipment or communications equipment or occupational therapy, that can all be covered under Jordan's Principle, including transit to get there. Now, the other thing is that substantive equality applies. What do I mean by that? Well, for many, many years, First Nations kids were getting less. So in order to get the same outcomes, they need to actually have more funding and more services than other kids to bring them up to standard. So even if a service is not available to a non-Indigenous child, that does not mean that Jordan's Principle will not fund it. As long as you can link it to the needs of a child. And as physicians, you are uniquely positioned to do this. You just simply write a note saying this child, in your professional opinion, needs this service or product. Now, the other thing that is that the federal government cannot take forever to respond. At least they're not supposed to. Right? They're supposed to get back to you in an urgent case. So say if you had a child presenting at your emergency room who needed urgent mental health care. They have to respond to that immediately. If it's a case, say, for a child with a wheelchair, they have to approve that case within 48 hours, or they're in breach of the tribunal's orders. They can't put administrative procedures ahead of the interests of the child, right? And we see this a lot with government where they say, well, you need to complete Form X or Form Y. That's not supposed to be happening. Jordan's Principle cases can be individual cases, so maybe regarding one child in your practice. It can be groups of children. So if you know in one particular First Nations community, there are a group of children who need occupational therapy, a request for a group service for those children can in fact go in. And it also is retroactive. So it goes back to 2009. Canada was using a very discriminatory and narrow definition of Jordan's Principle. I don't have time to get into detail here, but know that from the government Canada's perspective, there were 0 Jordan's Principle cases between 2006 and 2016. Somehow, there's been 165,000 since last year. But those children who should have been eligible, who are now young adults, can come back to Canada and get services. So this is particularly helpful for young adults with intellectual disabilities or physical disabilities or who need some trauma assistance. They can go back to Canada and get some supports. This is the most important slide. This is how you can make a Jordan's Principle referral. There is a 1-800 line 24 hours around the clock. It's available in French and it's available in English. Parents themselves may call this number. Children, young people can call this number. And so I really recommend that you have this for your work. We also on the Caring Society website have public service announcements that you can download either for your colleges or for the National College. And they are 60 seconds. And they're done by children explaining Jordan's Principle so everyone can understand. They're available in English, they're available in French, and in American Sign Language. So feel free to download those resources and distribute them. We're not interested in copyright privilege at the Caring Society, we're interested in people getting the information they need. And you'll also be able to download this poster and graphic and a whole pile of other information pieces about Jordan's Principle. So how do we honor Jordan's legacy? Well, number one, we make sure that when we're in contact with children, we're asking ourselves if their needs can be met by Jordan's Principle. Remember that Jordan's Principle is the law. It's not a policy or program for Canada. That we have to make sure that others in our circle are aware of it, because for many, many years, it existed in name only and wasn't being applied. So if you're aware of others in your hospital or in your medical practice or in your community circle, then have them go on to Jordan's Principle website and learn more about it. There's some challenges. The tribunal still is holding jurisdiction, and good for them. They want to make sure Canada actually implements all these orders, right? They've seen the long litany of the pattern of knowing the problems, having the solution, accepting it, and then not doing anything. And in fact, the 5 non-compliance orders issued against the Government of Canada since 2016 speak to that ongoing pattern. But it is getting a bit better. Here are the areas of controversy. Canada says all First Nations children includes status First Nations children on reserve and children eligible for status, and any other child on reserve who identifies as First Nations. However, they say it does not include non-status children off reserve. And we don't understand that logic. If you're going to fund them on reserve, why would you not fund them off reserve? So that is still something we're litigating with Canada about. If you find a child in your practice, they deny services on that, get a hold of us, and we will do what we can to assist you in making sure that child's needs are met. It's also not clear on how Canada is applying best interests of the child. The tribunal has ordered them to apply Jordan's Principle with that particular paramount consideration. We are working with Canada to develop a more robust test on that. But if you find them rejecting you because there's a gap or because there's no substantive equality, but they haven't addressed best interests, and you feel it is in the best interest of that child to receive that service or that young person, then let us know. And their following through on urgent cases is a bit problematic. We found that they're not necessarily classifying them properly, and they're not responding within a timely way. That's been brought to their attention and to the attention of the tribunal, and there have been some improvements. But again, if you have any concerns whatsoever, get a hold of us, and we will do what we can to assist you. And time frame of compliance is still an issue. Not on every single region, but Ontario, for example, is particularly problematic. So if you have any issues with that, let us know, because we don't want you as physicians to be spending all your time on the phone chasing down Canada, right? That's what Jordan's Principle was supposed to eliminate as well, to recognize that professionals like you, your time is best spent assessing patients and providing care, not messing around with bureaucracy. So if you get in that glitch, get a hold of us and we'll help. Now, on child and family services, which is the other element of the decision, Canada was ordered to fund those prevention services to help families stay out of care, which is a great thing. But Canada is not funding capital, so you can't fund a building to develop that youth center that would keep children out of care. That is still a subject of litigation. Canada has, however, announced $1.4 billion to go to child welfare over a period of 5 years. Now, that sounds like a lot of money. It signifies how deep the inequality was, but it's important for all of you to know that money has not been released by Treasury Board. Not a penny of it has trickled down to the children. So we need to be clear when we're evaluating Canada's efforts to redress the discrimination that we measure it at the level of the children themselves, not in these types of political announcements. What is the next step in the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal? Well, they're holding on to jurisdiction until March. We have a bunch of areas, as you see in Jordan's principle, that we want to address, as well as in child and family services. The tribunal retains the ability to make orders, which is also another reason I'm encouraging you to contact us if you have any glitches, because we can then get an order either hopefully by consent, but if not by consent, by adjudication, to force Canada to address those particular issues. And Canada is also going to have to compensate these kids. And under the Canadian Human Rights Act, you're allowed $20,000 per child, plus an additional $20,000 for willful and reckless discrimination. We're saying Canada was willful and reckless because it knew about it, it knew about the harms to children, and it failed to do it, right? Keep in mind, this is only one area of the inequalities experienced by First Nations kids. It doesn't deal with the inequalities in school buildings, in water, in these other areas. It tells you how difficult it is, how dead set in the DNA of the government this policy of discrimination is needed, right? One of the things that frustrates me the most is when I hear politicians say, we're going to announce some money for this part of First Nations communities. And to the general public, who already thinks we're getting more, it also just sounds like a huge pile of money. But the problem is they never tell you that they'd be spending far more if these were non-Indigenous kids. And I don't know of one circumstance where their announcement has actually addressed the scope of the inequality. Then we hear this. We hear, well, we cannot fix it overnight, right? This has been going on for a long time. It's almost like we have shortchanged these children for 152 years, so you can't expect us to fix it overnight, which I reject completely. They have this costed out by the Parliamentary Budget Officer, by the Auditor General, by their own studies. And if we are, as I said to the Finance Committee, I said, are you saying to us that you're so broke as a nation that the only way to keep our head above water is to racially discriminate against little kids? And if that is indeed what you're saying, because that is indeed what you're doing, then what are First Nations kids losing to, right? Becomes the question. What is more important than them? So just to look past the number of things that came over the news the last little while, we had the forgiveness of the Chrysler loan, right? The buying of the pipeline, $4.6 billion. Before that, we're sponsoring the World Cup if it comes here. Like, clearly that argument has no legitimacy. And we need to reject it on every turn. There's also an empirical basis for me saying this. In the Netherlands, there's a group called the Kids' Rights Foundation. And every year, they release an index called the Kids' Rights Index. What it does is it ranks countries on how well they're doing for all children. This isn't just First Nations kids, this is all kids. And says, how well are you doing proportionate to your wealth? Canada, of course, is a G8 country. And so you would expect that given our wealth, we would be doing better than most countries. But in this year's index, we rank 52nd in the world. Now, when you think about it, that's not surprising, because if you turn on CPAC and you listen to the provincial legislature or territorial legislature or the national legislature, ask yourself, how often do you hear the words child or children? Very rarely, right? And in fact, that's the part of the sub-index that we do the worst. There's a particular part called child rights environment that looks at how much of the budget and how much attention to children is given in legislation. In that particular ranking, Canada ranks 138th in the world. That would put us down with the third world countries. So clearly there's room for improvement, and I'm saying here on behalf of all children, right? Because in my view, every child is sacred, and every child is worth the money, right? So we have developed something to address all of these inequalities. Because one of the things that's stunning to me is in the 152-year legacy of this country, the government that implemented residential schools, the government that then was sued and found responsible for the 60s scoop, that was found responsible for doing medical experiments on First Nations kids, right? Remember Health Canada was depriving them of all those vitamins? That government has never had a plan to end these inequalities. There is no federal plan to end all of them. And without a plan, we're going to continue to see this drop in a bucket, program by program approach, and these inequalities are going to perpetuate across the time. So the Spirit Bear Plan has two key elements. One is get the parliamentary budget officer to cost out all of these inequalities. Let's see what the big ticket is, right? We're starting to see it with Jordan's principle and with child welfare, but let's add in water, let's add in early childhood programs, let's add in education and see what we get. And then develop something like the Marshall Plan after the Second World War, right? Where the Allies came together and they rebuilt Europe in 10 years. If we can rebuild Europe in 10 years, we can eradicate these inequalities far sooner than that. And I, for one, am prepared to sacrifice the pipeline, and I'm prepared to sacrifice the World Cup in order to make sure we do it, right? There's another thing that we have to get to. And that is, why have we all put up with this for so long, right? We look across the border and we see the egregious human rights that seem to unfurl out of the White House almost on a minute-by-minute basis. And many of us have tried to do what we could to protest some of these egregious rights violations, not only in the United States, but around the world. And yet, if we're really honest, we really haven't stood up against the inequalities in our own country. We have an apartheid system in Canada that disadvantages children. So how do we stop the federal government from replicating that discriminatory behavior? And how can we retool our own consciousness so we don't put up with it as the public? That's the second part of the Spirit Bear Plan, where we're asking for an independent 360-degree evaluation of the government of Canada's provision of child and family services under any service that affects kids. Let's see, despite their good intentions and despite their statements, what are those ways of thinking and doing that are perpetuating the discrimination? Let's make those come alive so we can deal with them, right? Because if we don't deal with that, that's going to continue to infiltrate the way that government sees itself as being legitimate. We have an antidote for the general public, and that is teaching children at the youngest ages about the history of Canada, First Nations, Métis, and Inuit peoples. And that is essential. But it's going to take a while for that to take effect. In the meantime, we have to rely on people like you to really question some of those assumptions and to join with us in a collective voice to say that we have to end these inequalities for First Nations children today, not tomorrow, but today, because it is really creating a backpack of disadvantage that's seen in every health and social statistic. As the historian John Malloy said, First Nations kids are at the top of every list you don't want to be a top of, and we're at the bottom of every list that you do want to be at the top of. And that can end if we implement the Spirit Bear Plan. We also have a book. One of the things that was really encouraging for us is during the tribunal, the group that showed up the most were children. Children don't rationalize this inequality. They can see it clearly, right? They say, well, this little kid is getting less because he's different than me. That's not right. And they would rally around, and they would be school buses pulling up in front of the courtroom, and children would fill it. And they'd bring teddy bears, which were Jordan's favorite toy, to recognize Jordan River Anderson. And so there's a book you can read on Jordan's principle and how these kids all came together. It's called Spirit Bear and Children Make History. We've donated copies to every children's hospital. And we've also donated copies to low-income communities and to women's domestic violence shelters, because we really believe in children's ability to make change for themselves. There's a documentary about the case you can watch free of charge online at the NFB. It's called We Can't Make the Same Mistake Twice. And sadly, I'd say we already did, and we're trying not to do it a third time, right? And that's our collective charge, but you can watch that online. And the kids have also continued their advocacy. What's been so amazing is that the children know it's not enough to write one letter. It's not enough to just have a day of protest, that they have to keep speaking up until things change. And they have now been doing this since the beginning of the tribunal hearings, right? And we have something called Have a Heart Day, where children of all diversities go to Parliament Hill, and what they decided is, who needs love more than politicians? So we're going to write them Valentine's. But our Valentines aren't going to just be like the ones we send to our grandmas and grandpas and moms and dads or our teacher. It's going to be so that First Nations kids get a fair chance to grow up safely in their homes, get a good education, be healthy and proud of who they are. Now, there were so many children coming into hearings that we actually had overflow. And one of the hearings happened on Valentine's Day. So that's where this Have a Heart Day came from. Now, there's two rules to Have a Heart Day. One is no adults speak. That in and of itself makes it an excellent event. And very efficient, might I say. The second is that it's done with love. These kids are not standing up in hate and anger. They're standing up in love because they know that it's on a basis of love that you can truly help this country become what it can be. You know, it is on that foundation. Some people said to us, well, aren't you teaching these kids to be political? And I said, of course I am, but not partisan. We teach them that in that house are people who can make decisions about children's health care, their education, and other things. And they have a right to be heard as children. And some of you might wonder, well, what about the non-Indigenous kids? How can they possibly get this? Well, I'm going to tell you one story, and then I'm going to close out here. There was a little boy who had autism. And like many children with autism, he was a child that didn't have a lot of confidence, would get bullied in school often. He had his hoodie down. You know, you've seen those kids in your practice, right? And he would sometimes act differently, and so was considered disruptive, so the other kids would distance themselves. But Have a Heart Day came, and he wrote out his Have a Heart Day thing. But then he threw it in the garbage. The teacher went and got it, smoothed it out, put it on his desk. He picked it up, and he threw it in the garbage again. Teacher goes and brings it back. And she says, why do you keep throwing it in the garbage? He said, because no one wants to hear from a kid like me. And when she explained that through his reading of his letter, that he can be part of a community and making things right for 165,000 kids, the kid's disposition shifted. He said, "You mean someone needs me? I could help other kids?" He gets on his parka. He's out in front of Parliament, and he has a microphone within hours. Imagine the moral courage that took, right? We talked about Bryce's moral courage, and this is moral courage, too. Do you want to hear what he said? He said, "Dear Prime Minister, do you have a cat? I have a cat. He's black. His name is Micah, because I like rocks, and he's a boy." Then he gets right down to business. And I think this is how we need to communicate with politicians. He said, "Stephen Harper, if you do not build more schools, you're going to create a crime wave and lose all of your money." Because kids who do not get proper schools cannot get good jobs when they're bigger. But they're still going to need money to live. So some of them are going to have to steal it. And then people in the communities are going to get mad because crooks are invading their homes. And he looks down at his paper. He says, "My teacher tells me that you are in charge. So you better man up right now and build more schools, love, Harry." Right? I think, you know, that letter has now been read in thousands of places all over the world, and Harry actually has a map where he sees where other people have heard his words. You know, children can see an injustice. They don't make excuses for it. They don't call committees for it. They do what they can as children to make it a fair and more just world for everyone. That's why we see the magic of the March for Our Lives movement in the United States and many other examples. I am 54 years old. When I was 3, there was a report written here in Ontario on the situation of Indians. It said, "Can anyone imagine, a guess, what year or what century real progress will be made towards the equality of the Indians?" What year or what century will real progress be made for the equality of the Indians? That answer is in each one of you. You are First Nations children's very best hope. So as you use Jordan's principle and you honor his name, remember that our work is not done. This country is better than racially discriminating against children, but only if we demand that it is. Because it has never been governments who have created this type of change. It has always been the people. And that means you. Thank you very much.
Merci, Dr. Blackstock. We greatly appreciate the important work that you're doing to inspire change, to protect the rights of Indigenous children, and ensure that they have access to quality health care. We hope that Jordan's principle will support positive changes, and we have every confidence that your leadership will be key to implementing those changes for better health care for all the people of Canada, now and in the future. I feel I need to get off my script a little bit just to remind us, following this address, that this organization has social accountability as one of its core elements in its strategic plan. And that as part of this, we do need to ask ourselves, individually, in our respective region, as well as on a pan-Canadian basis, what we can do as family physicians, as well as citizens. If you're a citizen of this country, that means you're an agent of change to try and address inequalities in this country. And so I hope that after an address like this one, we can all embark on this reflection and become agents of change. And I would like to invite Dr. Marie-Dominique Beaulieu, Chair of the Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine, to come forward for the presentation of the FAFM TD Insurance Spotlight on Achievement Award. Dr. Blackstock, would you like to come up? Photographer's there, we're good. So once again, we extend our sincere thanks to TD for their generous sponsorship of this award to support strong leadership dedicated to enhancing healthcare in Canada. And again, Dr. Blackstock, thank you for your inspiring presentation this morning, and congratulations on being the recipient of the 2018 FAFM TD Insurance Spotlight Achievement Award. And I would like to invite our president, Dr. Guillaume Charbonneau, to come forward and provide the State of the College address.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Good morning. All right, thank you so much. Maybe I'll abuse this a little bit because this is my last speech in front of you, and I really need to feel the energy of family doctor in this room. So I am pleased to welcome our members and special guests. Merci de votre présence ici ce matin pour cette allocation sur l'état du collège. C'est un plaisir pour moi de présenter les faits saillants de nos réalisations de la dernière année, de faire le point sur certains de nos défis et de jeter un coup d'œil vers la prochaine année. A theme that emerged over the past years was the need to demonstrate to government how valuable family physicians are to our healthcare system. Our release of the Family Medicine Professional Profile helped us define the specific responsibility of family physicians, the unique contribution that family physicians make to our patients and communities, and how family physicians need to be supported in those roles. Having the professional profile in place supports our advocacy work with government and other stakeholders. We tackled some significant issues over the past year, such as calling on EMR provider to reconsider limiting access to data, working with the CPSO to amend its policy to recognize that family medicine training equips new graduates with the skill needed to provide emergency room care in rural community, and supporting the House of Commons Standing Committee on Health in recommending universal single-payer public pharmacare system. We also advance work to address the national opioid crisis, support open pharma movement, and we successfully lobby the federal government on proposed taxation changes that would have increased the tax burden of family doctors. Personnellement, je suis extrêmement fier des efforts du collège visant à améliorer l'accès aux soins dans les communautés rurales et éloignées du Canada. Je pratique dans la petite communauté de Maniwaki au Québec et je comprends très bien les difficultés liées au recrutement et à la rétention des médecins dans ces régions. Cette année, le Collège a créé le comité sur la mise en œuvre du plan d'action pour la médecine rurale. Ce comité continuera de militer pour un meilleur accès aux soins dans les régions rurales et éloignées, pour une amélioration des normes sur le transfert de patients et pour un réseau pan-canadien de recherche en médecine rurale. In addition to our advocacy work, the college provides members with practical resources to help you care for patience and advance your skills. This year, we produce several best advice guides and release an innovation in family care and primary care series about caring for marginalized populations. Our journal, Canadian Family Physician, produced several guidelines and its first ever team supplement focused on intellectual and developmental disabilities. Dr. Lemire has introduced weekly messages to members to keep you informed of timely developments. We are giving members more information about our budget to make our finances more transparent. We are working on a dynamic new CFPC website, and we are developing a user-friendly portal to enhance member communication. Recevoir des commentaires directement de vous, nos membres, est énormément utile pour établir les priorités du collège. Durant mon mandat, j'ai eu le privilège de rencontrer un grand nombre de membres, ainsi que des représentants de nos sections provinciales, des résidents, des étudiants en médecine d'un bout à l'autre du pays. Notre sondage auprès des membres mené tous les deux ans est une source de commentaires essentiels. Plus de 5000 membres ont répondu au dernier sondage. Nous les remercions d'avoir pris le temps de nous transmettre leurs commentaires. Nous avons appris que les membres continuent de percevoir le Collège comme le porte-parole de la médecine de famille au Canada et qu'ils valorisent son rôle dans l'agrément des programmes d'études postdoctorales en médecine de famille. This feedback also told us that members want to be more aware of the work being done on their behalf. In that regard, several large initiatives came to completion over the past year. New residency accreditation standards were developed. We released the CanMed's Family Medicine 2017. The new standards of accreditation for residency program in family medicine, which you may know as the Red Book, were finalized. And a new national standard for CPD was introduced. These activities are essential to quality family medicine training and education in Canada. Going forward, there are many initiatives on the way. One major project is the refresh of the patient medical home model of care. We are updating the recommendation, continuing the implementation, and developing new resources in collaboration with our provincial chapters. Other key activities include fostering quality improvement in family medicine and building research capacity through the Practice Improvement Initiative. Evaluating the impact of Certificate of Added Competence on family medicine and creating new clinical resources and online learning tools to support you. Alors que mon mandat de président tire à sa fin, j'aimerais prendre quelques minutes pour remercier tous ceux et celles qui m'ont appuyé dans la dernière année. And I will need your help there. So, family doc? I said family doc! All right. So, first I would like to thank the staff of the college. We have fantastic people working to help us in leading family medicine, and I would like you to join me in thanking them by a round of applause. J'aimerais remercier en particulier Francine, avec qui j'ai passé beaucoup de temps cette année. Francine is really dedicated to the college and to family medicine. Francine, it was very great to work in team with you. Merci. I would like to thank our members who are involved in the college, including our chapters. Without your dedication and voluntary work, the CFPC could not provide such great value to its members. Je voudrais remercier mes collègues de Maniwaki qui m'ont aidé à offrir de l'accessibilité à mes patients et qui m'ont remplacé à l'urgence et à l'hospitalisation. Finalement, j'aimerais prendre le temps de remercier ma famille. They were on stage with me last year for my introduction, and I would like them to join me today so that they finish this fantastic journey, this fantastic but demanding journey with me. D'abord, j'aimerais remercier Karine Paradis. My wife and I are a family doc in a rural community where we have no family. Karine has helped us take care of our children since they were born, and she does so much to support us all. Merci, Karine. When I practiced my speech with my daughter, she was finding it very boring. Until this next sentence. Je voudrais remercier mes deux enfants, Benjamin et Chloé, qui m'ont supporté malgré les sacrifices pour la famille. I will tell you a little story. My children have learned and benefit from this experience, but they have also struggled with my absence. Family doc? All right, good, I needed that. So I was sorry to miss being with my children for Halloween when I was away in meeting. I, as a good family doctor, I talked to it about to my son, and his response really made me feel better. He said, "Don't worry, Daddy. I'll pick up more candy, and I'll keep some for you." My daughter really don't want me to give that. So, finalement, j'aimerais remercier ma conjointe, qui est également médecin de famille. She is a fantastic role model, and I'm proud that she will receive her fellowship of the CFPC on Saturday. Je te remercie pour ton support. Je suis très chanceux de pouvoir partager ma vie avec toi. So to all my colleagues, I am grateful to have had the honor of representing you as your president. Thank you for this memorable experience.
Merci, Guillaume. It's been a pleasure to work with you over the past year during your term as CFPC president. You have provided outstanding leadership and communication in a very progressive manner to effectively address many family medicine issues, advocate on behalf of our members, and always bring your own personal passion to every issue to enhance family medicine and our college. Ta contribution a été énorme. Et nous vous en remercions chaleureusement. On te remercie de tes réflexions engagées et de tes communications avec nous, avec nos membres et avec nos intervenants. Nous sommes très reconnaissants du temps que tu as si généreusement consacré au Collège au cours de la dernière année. Merci encore une fois. We will now proceed with the installation ceremony of our new CFPC president. C'est un plaisir pour moi de présenter les anciens présidents nationaux du Collège qui sont ici avec nous aujourd'hui. Les anciens présidents nationaux sont les témoins officiels de l'installation du nouveau président du Collège des médecins de famille du Canada. Merci à tous d'être ici aujourd'hui. I will now ask them to stand as I announce their name, and I'll ask you to hold your applause until they've all been introduced. Dr. Reg L. Perkin, President for 1981-82. Dr. Paul Petit, President 1984-85. Dr. Don Butt, President 1985-86. Dr. David Moores, President 1993-94. Dr. Cal Gutkin, past executive director and CEO between 1996 and 2002. Dr. Sherry Bethune, president 1996-1997. Dr. Don Gellhorn, president 2000-2001. Dr. Dominique Tessier, president 2001-2002. Dr. Peter McKean, president 2002-2003. Dr. Rob Waddell, president 2003-2004. Dr. Alain Pavilanis, president 2004-2005. Dr. Tom Bailey, president 2006-2007. Dr. Ruth Wilson, president 2007-2008. Dr. Sarah Credenzer, president 2008-2009. Dr. Kathy McLean, president 2009-2010. Dr. Rob Boulay, president 2010-2011. Dr. Sandy Buckman, president 2011-2012. Dr. Marie-Dominique Beaulieu, president 2012-2013. Dr. Kathy Lawrence, president 2013-2014. Dr. Gary Mazowita, president 2014-2015. Dr. Jennifer Hall, president 2015-2016. And Dr. David White, president 2016-2017. Your past presidents. Thank you. Dr. Charbonneau.
As my last official duty as president, it is now my honor to install Dr. Paul Sarchuk of Winnipeg, Manitoba, as the president of the College of Family Physicians of Canada for 2018-2019. I'll ask Dr. Sarchuk to please rise. Dr. Sarchuk, 1 year ago, you were chosen president-elect, and by the virtue of our bylaw, you are about to assume the presidency, the highest office of the College of Family Physicians of Canada. With your agreement to assume this office, do you accept the trust your peers have placed in you to become the leader and the main spokesperson for the College of Family Physicians of Canada? And Dr. Sarchuk, as our college president, do you agree to commit to carrying out our official duties and upholding the dignity and principles of this office by serving our college, its chapters, our members, and the specialty of family medicine with professionalism and honor? And to advocate on behalf of all of our members and the patient and the communities they serve. As I pass to you the Presidential Medal, the symbol of office for the ensuing year, I know you will wear it with pride, honor, and humility. At the close of your term, you will pass it on to your successor as a symbol of progress, loyalty, and devotion to the principle of the College of Family Physicians of Canada.
I don't dress up many men. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to present to you the 65th president of the College of Family Physicians of Canada.
Thank you very much. It is a privilege for my first official duty as president to honor our outgoing president, Dr. Guillaume Charbonneau. It is a great pleasure to present to you, Guillaume, this past president's pin as a token of our appreciation of your efforts and achievements on behalf of the college over the past year. You have been an awesome president.
Thank you, George. Thank you so much.
Dr. Charbonneau, Dr. Lemire, Dr. Blackstock, fellow board directors, national past presidents, chapter representatives, valued CFPC members, and honored guests. Good morning, bonjour. I am thrilled to be standing here in front of you as the president of the College of Family Physicians of Canada. I'm very honored to have this opportunity to serve you in this capacity. And I do see this as a service position, as well as a leadership position. I see it as in my role as president to listen to the membership and advocate for what I hear and to champion family medicine and family physicians. I hope to be able to do that effectively in the year to come. Je crois que c'est un bon moment pour les médecins de famille au Canada, malgré tous les défis. En médecine de famille, nous ne sommes jamais certains si le verre est à moitié plein ou à moitié vide. Nous ne recevons pas la même rémunération que nos collègues spécialistes. Nous ne recevons pas le même niveau de respect, ni le même soutien pour tout ce que nous voulons faire pour nos patients. Donc, notre verre n'est pas complètement plein. But our profession can be hugely rewarding. We know that we make a difference to our patients and the quality of their lives. We are there for them through every age and stage to support their health, and they appreciate our help. I'd like to share a story about one of my patients because I think it is symbolic of the important relationships that family doctors forge with our patients. One day I was working in a community health center on Main Street in Winnipeg, one of the poorest communities and poorest neighborhoods in Canada. On that day, my patient was an elderly man recovering from alcoholism. He told me that his Christmas shopping for that year was done. It consisted of buying two Christmas cards, one for his sister in British Columbia and one for me. And that floored me. Now, there are many aspects of that story that are moving. One, that a member of our society would only have $2 to participate in an important cultural tradition. Two, that he would only have two people that he would want to share with. And three, that one of those two people would be me, his family doctor. I remember feeling awkward and undeserving, but I also felt grateful that I could be there and help him experience greater connection. And I was also grateful that he helped me experience greater connection and deeper meaning. I recently had the opportunity to attend a Wonka Family Medicine Conference in South Korea. It provided me with some perspective about how good it is to be a family physician in Canada. In Canada, family physicians have a wide scope of practice. We work in clinics, we work in hospitals, we work in emergency rooms, delivery rooms, personal care homes. In many other countries, I found the family medicine scope of practice is much narrower. The role of family doctors in those societies much narrower. Here, we work in an environment of universally accessible healthcare, something we all appreciate when we look at other countries that cannot say the same. But while our system is good, we still have work to do. While access to healthcare is universally accessible, it is not equitably accessible. Those who live in rural and remote communities routinely struggle with appropriate access. Also, our system does not optimally serve many communities. Perhaps most striking, as we just heard from Dr. Blackstock, the Indigenous communities of Canada. We are on a difficult path of truth and reconciliation. It is crucial to our healing as a country. Nous devons faire plus pour comprendre la puissance et le potentiel de soins complets, globaux et continus. Pour progresser, nous avons besoin de plus de recherche et d'innovation en médecine de famille. Le Collège travaille actuellement avec des médecins de famille, des universités et des intervenants auprès des gouvernements provinciaux et fédéraux pour corriger cette situation. En tant que président, soutenir ces efforts sera l'une de mes priorités. A second priority for me will be the continued implementation of the patient's medical home. We've made good progress since the PMH model was introduced by the CFPC in 2011. Going forward, I believe that the most powerful improvements in the healthcare system will not be in the hospitals, they will be in the communities, and they will be led by you, the Family Physicians of Canada, and the CFPC will be right there by your side. Before I finish, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank a handful of the many people who have supported me over the last 25 years. I have always liked the expression, we can see far because we stand on the shoulders of giants. Three of the giants of my life are here today, Dr. Peter Newberry, Dr. Gary Mazzuita, and Dr. Mike Dillon. These men have been excellent role models, demonstrating a pragmatic approach to leadership, an unwavering focus on patient welfare, and a willingness to lead by example. Thank you, Gary, Peter, and Mike. J'aimerais remercier Francine et Guillaume pour leur soutien. Ils ont été d'excellents modèles au cours des dernières années. C'est un honneur pour moi de travailler avec eux et avec le reste des membres du conseil d'administration du collège. I'd like to thank my clinic colleagues, all of whom are here today. Amanda, Catherine, Christine, Erica, Sasha, Ainsley, and Jessica. You've inspired me to push forward and do better, and you take care of business during my frequent absences. You are awesome teammates. Thank you. My biggest influences, like many, have been my mother and father, Martha and Richard, who are also here today. Mom and Dad, you showed me how to balance a rich family life and a rewarding career. You have always provided me with the unconditional love that has been my foundation. Thank you. My children, Iris and Joe, are here as well. Iris and Joe, you have expanded my capacity to love and increased my understanding of what it is to be human. Thank you. And finally, Margaret, my wonderful and completely supportive wife. Margaret, you are the love of my life. Thank you. I would like to close with the expression, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Colleagues, let's go far. Let's go together. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul, and congratulations once again. We look forward to working with you in your new role in the year ahead. For a very special finale to this morning's program, I now invite Dr. David White, one of our former past presidents, to get his guitar for an original musical performance to help us welcome Dr. Sawchuk and kick off his presidency. And of course, we want you to join in. All right.
Thanks very much. Congratulations, Paul. This is a moment that is filled with formality, solemnity, a great deal of emotion, but a big part of it is celebration. And every morning we've been greeted by Guillaume telling us that family docs
rock!
and this is your opportunity. And I'm guessing somebody has a guitar here somewhere. Just I want to thank all the trustworthy people who are here today that this is still around. And while I'm doing this, let's hear it for the AV guys, Mark Robinson, who have made this possible today. You know this one, it's from Winnipeg. In the middle of the country where the wind blow wintry, there's a family doc who answered the call. Like you and me, let's hear it for our President Paul. Come on now, cause he'll be taking care of business every day, taking care of business every way, taking care of business every night, taking care of business, and Paul's all right. Job well done, but the work goes on and on every year. So we hand over the reins, the title and the chains. Let's all stand up and give Paul a cheer, cause he'll be taking care of business, taking care of business, and he'll be taking care of business, taking care of business. He's out of sight. Come on. See family docs like you and me are working hard in primary care. Let's give family docs a hand all across this land. Celebrate our work everywhere, cause we'll be taking care of business every day, taking care of business every way, taking care of business. We're all right, taking care of business. We're out of sight. Come on, taking care of business every day, taking care of business every way, taking care of business. We're all right, taking care of business. We're all fine.
I think it's a fitting, uplifting end to the installation of Dr. Sawchuk as president. Ceci conclut la séance de ce matin. J'aimerais remercier tous ceux et celles qui ont participé au programme et bien sûr tous ceux et celles qui sont ici présents de faire du FMF un véritable succès. Please enjoy the morning break in the exhibit hall, and I wish you all a productive day of learning. Thank you very much.